Hey everyone, Ibar here with Hardware Canucks, and not too long ago I posted my review of the Razer Blade Stealth, which is a thin and light 13-inch ultrabook, and I really liked it. I mean, the design and the way how Razer just upgraded a few things here and there was absolutely great. But the price for the upgraded version that I had was just a bit too expensive. Basically, the base model had a Whiskey Lake i7-8565U 8-thread CPU, 8 GB of RAM, and a 256 GB SSD, but the graphics model, which I had, came with 16 GB of RAM, an NVMe SSD rather than a SATA-based drive, and a discrete MX150 GPU. That version is about $200 more expensive, but it got me wondering if the discrete graphics card really made a huge difference. You see, NVIDIA's MX150 has been rolled out to a few ultrabooks and some entry-level notebooks, and I think that trend is supposed to accelerate through 2019. But I want to throw in some more tests to see if it was really worth the extra cost over the lower battery life that we used to get with Intel's integrated solution. So let's find out right after this.
Excuse me, please explain.
This is easy.
Two systems fully powered by a single power supply.
Oh.
Just like me and you. Two bodies powered by a single mind.
Just imagine the good we can do.
The Revolt X by Fantex, a high-performance unit for multi-CPU, GPU, and dual-system configurations with 80-plus platinum efficiency with entirely silent fan mode, a 12-year warranty, and clean cable management. Explore the opportunities with the Revolt X PSU by Fantex. Links below.
All right, so let's first get into what the MX150 really is, because the name doesn't really give any hints, even though that it has been out for quite a while now. As a matter of fact, it seems like NVIDIA went out their way to rebrand an older architecture so it looks something different. Basically, this GPU uses a slightly evolved version of the GP108 core from NVIDIA's GT1030 GPU. That means it uses the Pascal architecture and has 384 CUDA cores, 24 texture units, and 16 ROPs. There have also been some modifications to lower core voltages, improve power consumption, and level out clock speed consistency. Those are all key aspects for ultrabook designs like the Razer Blade Stealth. The big question mark is clock speeds and memory. Those two specs are determined by laptop manufacturers and are largely based on their internal cooling solutions. For example, the Razer is running the MX150 at 1531 MHz and has 4 GB of GDDR5 memory, which gives it a TDP of roughly 25 watts. Other slim 13-inch notebooks with this GPU runs at just 1037 MHz and comes with just 2 GB of memory, but they also have a TDP of just 10 watts. That means Razer is sacrificing some battery life for increased performance. This also brings up a pretty interesting point, guys. When a notebook says that it comes with an MX150 GPU, you'll need to pay very close attention to whether or not if you're getting the 2 GB 10-watt version or the 4 GB 25-watt model, because the performance difference will be very different. Another interesting point about the MX150 is that it doesn't have NVIDIA's NVENC hardware-based video encoding engine. That means it can't be used to boost performance tasks like video transcoding. You'll need to use a CPU for that. It does, however, have NVDEC decoding, so playback or video playback will be accelerated by the GPU. With all of that taken into account, let's get on to the tests. All of these were run on the Stealth 16 GB model with the MX150 either completely disabled or enabled. For gaming, I decided to pick a handful of simple popular games that don't necessarily take a ton of resources and which people might likely be interested in playing while they're away from their main PC. You can see that the MX150 4 GB delivers a huge amount of additional performance against the integrated graphics card, which was pretty much expected. With it, games that are slideshows with Intel graphics becomes perfectly playable. And mind you, this is all at 1080p resolution, so if you tweak around with settings here and there, I think the MX150 would be absolutely a perfect companion, especially if you're traveling and if you just want to throw in something on an ultrabook. Now, I also want to dig in a little deeper into some other tasks. You see, a thin and light 13-inch ultrabook with a price tag like the Stealth would typically be expected to pull double duty for content creators and professionals while they're away from their office, because they'd normally use their workstation PC to get their job done. But can the MX150 really make a difference in terms of rendering performance and other tasks that would typically bring an ultrabook with Intel's integrated graphics solution down to its needs? Let's start with Handbrake for video transcoding. And here, the MX150 couldn't even be used because it lacks the NVENC encoder. However, Intel's QuickSync hardware video encoder does an amazing job in cutting down times versus just using the CPU. There's also very little change in Premiere Pro, since this program also uses the NVENC to accelerate rendering times. But I also have to mention that Intel's Quick Sync doesn't come in handy here, since it used to reduce rendering times. And I think the reason, and I think this might be, it's just my theory, I think what's happening here is that when Adobe recognizes that the system has, you know, Intel CPU and integrated GPU as well as a discrete graphics card, and when you enable Quick Sync, Adobe thinks that, okay, I'll just offset some of the loads equally or distribute it across the discrete graphics card, the integrated GPU, and of course the CPU. But since the MX150 doesn't have an NVIDIA encoding engine, it just freaks out. I think that's what I think. And it just offsets all of that load to the CPU, and the integrated GPU just sort of kind of, it doesn't get utilized to its best. And I think that's why it takes significantly longer to render, you know, 4K videos or whatnot. So I don't think the MX150 is, you know, a greater solution when it comes to just playback, or not playback, but just rendering performance in Adobe Premiere. Now, V-Ray is a rendering program that can be added to a huge number of applications like SketchUp, Maya, Cinema 4D, and more. In those cases, it is usually used to render high detail scenes, which means it takes a ton of system resources. Here, the MX150 makes a huge difference, since CUDA can be processed through the rendering quickly, while the CPU is left aside for other tasks. Blender is a bit different, with the 8-threaded CPU and the MX150 being pretty close in rendering times, so it doesn't look like NVIDIA's card gives an advantage here. Alright guys, so while I was running V-Ray and Blender, I did notice that the CPU was only being utilized by like 5-10% in order to process the final image. And the reason for that is basically pretty simple. Those programs primarily use GPU to accelerate or render the final output. Now that got me thinking, would it be possible to run parallel rendering tasks that could use both the CPU and the GPU without actually sacrificing output time? Now, I know this might not sound like a big deal, but for professionals, this could be a huge time saver, because think of it this way. For many design and architectural projects, you will obviously require multiple renderings at different angles. Now, if there's a revision made at some point, those renderings will obviously have to be reprocessed, and if you're doing one at a time, it just takes forever. But think of it this way, if you can pop out two at a time while traveling, or if you leave the CPU to do other tasks, that could be an awesome reason to look into something like the MX150. Now, in order to do this, I opened up two instances of these programs, and I set one for CUDA and the other one for CPU. And the results are pretty darn interesting. You see, when processed individually, the CPU took about 12 minutes to complete, and the GPU took about 15 minutes. However, when the MX150 and the CPU are running on two different renderings in parallel, both will be done in just over 15 minutes. Sure, the CPU does take a little bit longer, but in this case, you'd be able to almost double your output. Now, V-Ray uses a bit more processor resources when the GPU is rendering, so when both are running at the same time, the CPU time increases by quite a bit. However, you are still much better off running two scenes together on different pieces of hardware than waiting around for two CPU renderings to complete one after the other. All right, guys, so what about battery life? Now, I wanted to mention right away that while I made sure that the MX150 wasn't working during the IGP tests, it can't be completely turned off, so it isn't drawing any power. Even when it isn't in use, it remains in hibernation, which still requires some battery flow, so take that into account. Dedicating the IGP to graphics tasks obviously does extend battery life, and not having the MX150 at all would probably result in even longer times. A GPU with a 25-watt TDP in a slim and light notebook will obviously have a pretty big impact on how long it can remain unplugged. So take that into account before jumping onto the MX150 train. So I guess it's time to wrap things up. You see, at the very beginning of this video, I had a very simple question. Is the MX150 really worth it over Intel's integrated graphics card? And the answer to that really depends on what you're looking for in a 13-inch thin and light ultrabook. You see, if you're someone who thinks that you're going to be using applications like V-Ray or Blender, if you're an architect or designer that sees yourself taking advantage of, you know, those extra CUDA cores to accelerate your rendering output, or if you're just thinking of doing some light gaming here and there, and if you're looking for a pretty compact notebook, then the MX150 is actually worth it. Although, keep in mind that you need to make sure that what model you're getting, because there are a lot of notebooks out there that come with the 2GB 10W TDP GPUs, and of course, there's the 25W 4GB model, which is found on the Razer Blade Stealth. So that's definitely something to consider, but in my case, I really can't use something like the Razer Blade Stealth, because for video rendering, or for content creators or video editors, the MX150 is of no use because it doesn't have the encoding engine, and it just wouldn't really make any sense because your rendering times would almost quadruple. So that's where I would look into something with that's a little bit more powerful, like a GTX 10 series card or even the latest RTX GPUs, although they're very expensive, so yeah. And guys, remember, parallel rendering is just not for notebooks featuring MX150 graphics cards, because you can apply the same concept to your desktop workstation PC or even your laptop that has capable hardware, because if you can utilize every single piece of the hardware to accelerate your particular rendering task, then it's a win-win. Also, don't forget, if you're just looking for something that can do casual tasks like browsing the web, watching, you know, content or something like that, just normal stuff, then you're better off going with a laptop that doesn't have the MX150 GPU, because yeah, first and foremost, you're gonna get longer battery life and it's gonna cost you a lot less. So that's it for me. Thank you very much for watching. Let me know what you guys think about, you know, NVIDIA's MX150 GPU, and what do you think of it slowly starting to enter into the ultrabook market? Because I see that, or at least I think it's gonna become the trend for 2019. So I wanna know your thoughts about that. And of course, what do you think about the performance? And of course, things on parallel rendering and the idea of that. I'm Ibo with Hardware Canucks. Thank you so much for watching. Make sure to check out some relevant content over here. Subscribe to our Boot Sequence channel. And I'll see you in the next one.